You open it up into a mature ocean. So it's plate tectonics. Alfred Wegener had it right. Continental drift plus seafloor spreading gives us the theory of plate tectonics. Tectonic is Greek to build. Tectonics is Greek to build. The architecture of our Earth's surface, oceans and on land, mountains to valleys, are built by moving plates, moving away, moving toward, moving side, crunching, munching, munch away. And the Pacific Ring of Fire, whoa. The Pacific Ocean is remarkable. It's actually closing today. It's spreading the fastest. But it's subducting almost all the way around, with the exception of where the San Andreas Fault is, at the Transform Fault. It's actually starting to close. The Atlantic Ocean has much slower spreading. The Indian Ocean is slower spreading, but they're both getting wider. Okay? In fact, the Atlantic Ocean is so young, it has very little subduction. The Caribbean, a little bit, and down in the southernmost Atlantic at the South Sandwich Islands. All right, so there we go. Three types of plate boundaries. We call it divergent, convergent with a subduction zone, and transform, where we're sliding past one another. So let's look at divergent first. Seafloor spreading, making our oceans. Here is the Atlantic Ocean. It's spreading. The only subduction zones are here in the Caribbean. Let's go. Look out. And the South Sandwich Islands near the Scotia Sea in the southernmost Atlantic. Continental rifts, divergent. These rifts, your chains, the upwellings inside our mantle moves from place to place, finds itself underneath a continent, and starts rifting that continent. East Africa is rifting today. It's interesting. The Mediterranean is still closing from continental collision. The Mediterranean is still closing, but look out. Here comes the Indian Ridge system breaking its way, rifting. It's already rifted the Gulf of Aden and the Red Sea, and then two arms are rifted the Sinai Peninsula, trying to get into the Mediterranean. It's like worms trying to get in, snakes into your household. Somebody's in here. So one arm for the Gulf of Aden, one arm for the Red Sea, and then one arm. So this is a plate boundary. The third arm, not yet one, but is becoming one, and that's the East Africa Rift. A beautiful place. Some of the highest volcanic mountains, Mount Kilimanjaro, shall we go? Lake Victoria, Tanzania, let's go. Wonderful preserves. That, I look at that picture, and it's lovely, Lake Victoria, but I'm seeing rifting. And there was a story once. Have you ever seen the movie or read the book Out of Africa? A wonderful love story with Meryl Streep and Robert Redford.
What he knew wasn't the end of Africa.
I'll pause and have some coffee.
That was small and rare. We lived disconnected and apart from things. I had been making up stories while he was away. In the evenings, he made.
How many of you have seen this? And more of you will now. It's a wonderful love story.
With me sitting cross-legged like Scheherazade herself, he would listen.
She bought a farm in Africa. They grew coffee where no one had grown coffee up so high before. And suddenly, the first airplane. They've never seen one. Geology in just a moment. This is a true story.
Did you get it?
Mombasa! Get it!
Can you imagine doing this? Would you do that?
When did you learn to fly?
Yesterday.
Would you do this? Do you have a fear of flying?
Yeah.
Raj. One propeller, two wings, but look. In Eastern Africa, Kenya, a river with a flood bank, a river that floods over a lava fall. Subduction zone, one plate going down on the other, an inclined zone of earthquakes, here color-coded with blue shallow, darker green middle and red deep earthquakes. Look at that. Think twice before you live near a subduction zone. All right? I mean, look at the abundance of earthquakes on spreading ridges. Look at the abundance of earthquakes in East Africa. Not very many. Look at the abundance of earthquakes in the San Andreas. A little bit more. But look at the earthquake. Look at the earthquake associated with subduction zone. Don't you get down to Mexico City. Are you kidding? And they're color-coded. Here, blue is shallow, yellow is middle, and red is deep. They're all inclined. Subduction zones that go down some 500 kilometers. When these earthquakes go, the earth rings like a bell. Violent, abundant, and they can reach far. This is Mexico City. That's way inland, 2,000 miles. But it sits on an old lake bed. And when you sit on water-saturated ground, you get what we call liquefaction, a jelly effect. Look at that. Am I scaring you? And not just the earthquakes, the volcanoes, the most powerful volcanoes on Earth, with the power to blow rock debris into Earth orbit, where it circles the Earth.
Wow.
Subduction zones. Wow. So it's all here. You subduct down, earthquakes, about 100 kilometers in, I'm melting, because it's hot down there, and then the rising magma, because it's buoyant, rises. And it's full of gases, which are going to come out and explode, all right? We have the kind of subduction zone modeled after the Andes. We call it the Andean margin, where we're subducting ocean crust beneath a continent. And you get the deepest part of the world, right there. That's a trench. The average seafloor is 15,000 feet below sea level, but the trenches go down 33,000 feet. Is there life down there? Yeah. Yeah. It's wild, all right? So that's the Andean margin subducting down. And at some point, about 100 kilometers in, it starts melting, making volcanoes, and that rises to make the Andean Mountains. On the other side of the world, we've modeled after Japan, we have a subduction zone of ocean crust beneath ocean crust. And so out at sea, you get volcanic islands. And they're often arcuate because the Earth is round. Japan, it's arcuate. When you subduct, and if the Earth were flat, and I subducted, I would have a straight intersection, right? If the Earth was flat, and I intersected, and I subducted, I would have a straight intersection. Like the Earth is round. So when I subduct, the intersection is a curve. So we call these kinds of islands, always next to a trench, an island arc. An island arc. And look at Japan. And Japan has got two subduction zones. Here comes the Marianas Trench, from the Marianas Islands. And here is the Japan Trench. Look at that. Tokyo. And the big earthquake last March, epicenter right there, right there. Let's go. Look at that. 8.9. This is huge. The Earth has a 9 or 8.5 or 8.8. Maybe once every few years. Not very abundant. And they're powerful and they're deadly. All right? So 8.9 followed by a tsunami, and there it comes. The ocean goes out, sea level, the seas disappear. What do you do if you're standing at the shoreline and the ocean goes away? Run like hell. All right, there you go. So here's Tokyo. Where's Tokyo? There's Tokyo. Here's the epicenter. There's the trench. And look at all the aftershocks. So you have no warning. We used to think we could predict earthquakes. We cannot. We can only talk about probability. Are they going to continue to happen? You bet. How often? Well, let's just see how often it's happened in the past. And we'll look and count on that. All right. Look at that. Maybe you shouldn't think about going to Tokyo. Or maybe now's the time to go. It's all been relieved. But look at these pictures. Look at that. Look at that. Tsunami swept ashore, tossed around. Here comes the water, taking boats far inland. Oops. Here comes some more. Crashing through. Get out of that house. Run, run. Tossed around like toys. Like on your bedroom floor. And fire. That's at one of the... Japan has hardly any oil. It's a major industrialized nation. Coming back from World War II, with a lot of our help, it is now a major world center. But they need power. They don't have coal. They don't have natural gas. They don't have petroleum. So what are they going to do? Just like what Germany did. Just like what France did. All right? They built nuclear power plants. Taking uranium, enriching it, what we're trying to tell Iran that it should not do. Well, look at everybody else is doing it. But Japan built them right at the seashore. And they used seawater as part of the process. Because they needed to cool things down. And the way you make electricity is almost always with water. Because you just use the nuclear power to make heat. To boil. And the force of boiling, you go from water to the volume of steam, you drive a turbine. You drive a turbine. It's the same with a coal-powered or natural gas-powered plant. You're turning a turbine with heating water to steam. And in that turbine, you've got magnets that run past each other. That creates moving electrons, and you've got a current. So that's how you make electricity, okay? Except it's nuclear. And suddenly, you rupture the land. You got a giant earthquake. The cells are broken. They were not double-holed. Look out. Man, all kinds of things were look at that rupture. Was that a road? God. And there they are. There's the nuclear power plants. All right? They're burning up. Nuclear power is burning. So the next step is they're using ocean water to put the fires out. And of course, that water comes right back out into the ocean and it's contaminated. Right? So this is a story you know about. This is really interesting. Oh, you're not going to run. Earthquake waves can be compressed synthetically so we can hear them. And so this is sonification, sonar, of earthquake waves. Why aren't you running? You did a moment ago. Just a second. Oh. May not work. Why don't you work? Don't know. It worked a moment ago. In my office, you worked. Go. Go. Elapsed. Go. 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 I'm slowly dying. I'm dying. All right, forget it. But it will, maybe I'll get that to run later. All right, so looking at the subduction zones, Pacific has Andean on the east side, Japan type, all the way down, coming from the curved Aleutian Arc, down through the Kuriles, there's Japan, to the Philippines, to the Marianas, down near New Hebrides, all the way around Antarctica, down this side past Mexico, and the Andes of South America. So it's quite there. And this is how continents grow. Continents grow by rising magma, making volcanoes. Here's a cross-section through the Seattle-Portland region, creating new crust by volcanism. Subduction zone also causes continents to grow by a process we call accretion. And that's the scraping off of the ocean floor, the scraping off. So I said I don't want to die in the ocean because I'm going to get subducted, but I might get lucky and get scraped off. Scrape off and make part of the coast ranges. Look out. So we start with a baby island, a brand new subduction zone, an island offshore. And it's in a curvature belt of volcanic islands because the earth is round. It gets bigger with time, more mature, like the Philippines and Japan. They've been there a long time. And then finally, what's going to happen to this ocean? What's going to happen to that ocean? It's going to collide. It's going to close. And so subduction leads to closure and continental collision and the end of that process. That's the makings of the Himalayan mountains today. It's how the Appalachian Mountains formed. The Appalachian Mountains were formed by continental collision that later re-rifted to make the Atlantic. Look at this story. Here is North America, early North America. It had a subduction zone out in the ocean and a second one out in the ocean as well. This was an older crustal fragment. But what's going to happen to that Marshall Sea with that kind of geometry? What's going to happen right there? It's going to close. And so now that fragment gets slammed in. That's the Blue Ridge of North Carolina. That island arc is still offshore. What's going to happen to that sea? It's got to close too, all right? That creates a slate belt. And then, what's going to happen to this sea? The proto, the early Atlantic before the Atlantic, finally closed. So Africa slams in, creates the Appalachian Mountains like the Himalayas today. And then it rifted and left part of Africa. Florida is part of Africa. And part of New England is over in England. Yeah, hit that, right? It later re-rifted. So this cycle is called the Wilson cycle, after the geologist had discovered that there is a cycle of things, that you rift, you make a sea, you make an ocean, and then you subduct and you close it, only to be reopened sometimes. The Himalayan mountains are young. The Ural Mountains. Anytime you find a mountain belt inside a continent, it's formed by continental collision and the disappearance, the closure of a seaway. And a remarkable rock, green like a serpent, green like a snake, called certainty. Only if it's formed in the Earth's mantle, but during continental collision, it gets knocked out of the mantle and thrust up on land. Like you have two semi-trucks colliding on a freeway, knocking up asphalt. Knocking up part of the Earth's mantle, serpentinite. We find it only in mountain ranges like the Urals and parts of the Appalachians, parts of the Himalayas, where a sea is closed. So I nicknamed it the spirit of Ocean's Past. And some parts of serpentine are asbestos that form. I bring some down here, and at some point I will blow it into the room, and look out, I'll give you cancer. All right, there it is, spirit of Ocean Past, the stages of continental collision, look out. So we created an ocean floor by spreading, and now we're closing it, an immature island arc, a bigger one, and then finally it's getting closer, and slam dunk, Magic Johnson style, we bring down the ocean, dragging it down. This will be the end of subduction, but it'll take about 60 million years to end. The Alps of Southern Europe were made this way. All the way across. Look at that. So we get an interior mountain belt. How do we make these? Only by collision of continents, creating a double thickness of continental crust. It's like when I was in college, one joke people would do to bring out laughter in the hallway, they'd go down to a bathroom and boys or girls, doesn't matter, they take a toilet roll off the roll and they put it down in the toilet and flush. Is it going to go down? No, and pretty soon it's flooding the hallways and classes get canceled and we're all laughing. We think it's silly. So I don't want to do that. But that's a lot like continental collision because the continent is too light. The toilet roll paper is too light and too big to go down. And so it sucks everything up. Flooding water! So Pangaea, Alfred Wegener had it right. There it is. The beginnings of the Tethys Sea, it is called. And as it rifts, the Tethys Sea now is coming all the way across. You can see where the Rock of Gibraltar is soon going to be. Laurasia moving to the north, Gondwana land to the south. Now we're breaking up. India, hey, come back here. Now the South Atlantic is open. The North Atlantic is open. Gondwana land, once together, is breaking apart. Laurasia hanging in there. And then finally India breaks in to make the Himalayas the highest mountains on earth. And when we go to these great high mountains, walk with me through the Appalachian Mountains from southernmost Georgia all the way to Maine, you find lots of great rock, lots of granite, but also lots of rock from the ocean floor. That rock up there, it's got marine fossils on it. It came from the ocean floor. How do we do that? So we collide. Here comes India. Look out, slamming it in, breaking up of Pangaea, all breaking apart to a state more like it is today. The closure of the Tethys Sea. Used to be there. Here it goes, the Himalayas. And we traced the Himalayan mountains then all the way across Iraq, Iran, all the way over to the Alps, through above Turkey. That's all continental collision. The Pyrenees, all right? There we are. The Mediterranean is part of the Tethys Sea. It just has not yet closed. And all these mountain ranges, there are the Pyrenees, Transylvania, and look at that, all related to the collision of two great masses. And at the tops of those mountains, we find folded rock that once was sedimentary on the ocean floor, sometimes having fossils. James Hutton first recognized this. He says, I go to every mountain, and I find at the tops of the mountains a rock that came from the ocean floor. He said, what's that about? I told you, design. At the tops of mountains, there's rocks from the bottom of the ocean. What's that about? And what that is about is what was once the edge of the ocean, receiving sediment with fossils of things that were living and dying, will later become the site of subduction. Seafloor spreading makes oceans, but someday those oceans will close, and when they close, they push all hard on these sediments and push them up into mountains. The Appalachians here is just an example. The Canadian Rockies, all layered. Those are sedimentary rocks, don't you see? Sedimentary rocks, 500 million years old, Cambrian. We call that a geocline, that wedge of sediment offshore of an ocean. Okay? So it brings us to the concept of what we call orogeny. Orogeny is everything about subduction. Volcanism, metamorphism, heating, faulting, earthquakes, and the making of land and the making of oceans. It's all called orogeny. It makes mountains. Look at that. So here, today, New England is no longer making mountains. The Appalachian Mountains are old. They're dead. They're eroding away. Parts of the Appalachian Mountains are up in the United Kingdom. All right? Florida belongs to Africa. But the mountain ranges stretching down the Cordillera, as we call it, all the way down from Alaska through British Columbia, the Sierra Nevada Mountains, down into Mexico, through Central America and South America, all forming today, okay, by orogeny. Subduction zones, magmas rising, colliding, and there we got two great belts of earthquakes, and certainly the biggest one, the most intense, is the Circumpacific. The next great belt of earthquakes, not bad, is continental collision from the Mediterranean all the way across to the Himalayas, which you can see connects to modern-day subduction zones in Indonesia. So there we got the Wilson cycle. We rift, we create an ocean, we collide it, and you re-rift it, all right? You get parts of that same mountain belt on opposite sides of that ocean. So the last 500 million years of Earth history, 500 million years ago, we had geoclines. Once again, that sediment being deposited at the edge of rifted continents, where it had rifted, and oceans are there now. And so you have sending sediment off the shores of New Jersey, making a geocline, all right? But then, what does ocean floors, what's going to happen to them? At some point, they're going to start closing. So 410 million years ago, we had collision. Europe and Asia collided and closed and made the Ural Mountains, never to reopen. 370 million years ago, collision. Europe and North America collided to make the Northern Appalachians. That's us. Wow. 290 million years, collision. Africa collided with North America to make the Southern Appalachians. So it was a double bang collision. We had Pangaea. Then Pangaea started rifting. Lasted a long time. Age of dinosaurs. Then it started rifting, made Laurasia and Gondwana land. Then Laurasia rifted, then Gondwana land rifted. And then in the last 100 million years, we started colliding. Africa collides with Europe to make the Alps. We just did that. Island arcs were slamming into California to make the Sierras and the Rockies. India collided with Tibet to make the Himalayas. Now, even younger, East Africa today is rifting. The Rio Grande River of Colorado down to Texas tried to rift and stopped. San Andreas Fault is a young fault, only 20 million years in age, and the San Gabriel Mountains caused by the bending of the San Andreas, only 6 million years in age. And watch this movie. It's my last one. Watch this. Here's Pangaea. It is distorting. It's moving around, but it's still together. Pangaea. All right? Who's going to rift? Who's going to rift? Oh, look, the Atlantic's open! So now I've got Laurasia, and here is Gondwana land. So the Northern Atlantic is opening. India is getting out. The South Atlantic is open. Here's the ages, 96, 93, 90, 90 million years ago. There's the Atlantic. India, get back here! You come here right now! And he slams in there, picks up a microcontinent. Australia moving out. The modern world. Have I shouted enough at you today? All right. Part two of plate tectonics and earthquakes on Thursday. Have a great day.